Back at the turn of the century, nobody liked the Morgan Dollar. It was considered bulky, heavy, just downright awkward and ugly. Ah, they just hated it. But nowadays, the most important and the most widely collected American coin is the Morgan Dollar. The Morgan Dollar had its origins through an act of Congress. February 28, 1878, the Bland-Allison Act was passed. Bland being representative from Missouri and Allison being representative from Iowa, both these guys had their hands kind of in the silver industry, and that's one reason why they put this bill into action. Then President Rutherford B. Hayes actually vetoed the original bill. He didn't like it, he thought it was bad. He sent it back to Congress. Congress passed it above his head, and it actually went into being. The Bland-Allison Act stated that the U.S. Treasury Department was to buy $2 to $4 million of silver bullion and convert that into the new dollars. Passage of this bill actually helped silver miners out west in Virginia City and Leadville, Colorado, because it bought up a large part of the silver market. The new dollar was to be 412.5 grains. That's 90% silver, 10% copper. And at the time, the coin itself had about 89 cents worth of silver bullion in it. In 1877, the Philadelphia Mint went nuts because they realized that more than likely an act of Congress was going to be passed to create a new silver dollar. Chief engraver William Barber and assistant engraver George T. Morgan started creating and testing about 24 different pattern designs for the new dollar. On February 21st, 1878, Mint director Henry Linderman actually selected the new pattern, or the actual coin that he was going to use, with some little altered things for the new dollar that was to be produced. And that pattern, of course, was George T. Morgan's, hence the name the Morgan Dollar. However, considering it was George T. Morgan's actual design, the Morgan Dollar was considered for a very, very long time the Bland Dollar. The Morgan Dollar's obverse of Miss Lady Liberty is probably modeled after Miss Anna W. Williams, who Morgan actually met through another fellow artist he knew named Thomas Eakins. Now, the obverse of Lady Liberty is probably altered a little bit, but the basis for it is off Miss Williams. Now, the reverse itself got mixed reviews. On the back is the American Eagle. A lot of publications at the time said the bird was too small, sickly looking. They just gave it horrible reviews. But this wasn't the first time that publications have given American coinage back in the 1800s bad reviews. Most of the time, they always gave them bad reviews. During the first year of the Morgan Dollar, dies were sent to the three operational mints at the time: the Carson City Mint in Carson City, Nevada, the Philadelphia Mint, of course, and the San Francisco Mint. And in 1879, it was actually sent to the New Orleans Mint for production too. The 1878 Morgan Dollar reverse is very interesting. It has 8 tail feathers. Now, that was its original intent, as 8 tail feathers, but within 2 weeks of production, Mint director Linderman actually changed it from 8 to 7 tail feathers. He did this because in nature, most birds have an odd number rather than an even number of tail feathers. So this created a very interesting variety within the 1878 Morgans. The changing of the hubs actually created 3 different varieties within the 1878 Morgans. The first is the 8 tail feathers. There are an estimated 750,000 Philadelphia 1878 8 tail feather reverses out there. Now, there's also 8.7 million 7 tail feather Morgans out there from the Philadelphia Mint. And the third variety, which is the one that I would probably look for, are the 7/8 tail feathers, which is kind of interesting because there's 7 tail feathers, but underneath it you can see 8. The Morgan Dollar had a good run. It ran from 1878 until 1921. Now, there's kind of a gap in between there, because in 1904, they stopped making the Morgan dollar. They stopped making it because they had a lot of them. They didn't need any more. So they didn't start making it again until 1921, and they only made it for 1921 because the Morgan dollar was replaced by the peace dollar. And we'll talk about the peace dollar in another episode. Now, when looking at Morgans, you're going to notice lots of different grades on them, all the way from a PR1 on the Sheldon scale to a Mint State 67. There might be a Mint State 68 out there, but I don't recall there being one. But if there is, I'm probably might be wrong on that. So just going to tell you that right now. But most of them stop from a grading service at a Mint State 67. And that's the highest that I know of. Now, with the strike, there are different strikes for each mint. Now, you're going to notice the weakest strike is in the New Orleans Mint. And you can see this on the breast feathers on the reverse of the Morgan. They're not going to be very detailed. And you also see this in the cap and the hair on the obverse of the New Orleans Mint. Now, sometimes this can be seen in the Philadelphia Mint, too. Now, for the coins with the best strike, those are going to come from the San Francisco and the Carson City Mint. Trends in actually collecting the Morgan dollar. Well, there's a lot of trends out there, and they change over the years. Right now, the Carson City Mint Morgans are hot. Any of them, from 1878 all the way up to 1893. They're just all hot. If you wanted the lowest mintage Carson City, that would be the 1885, and if you can actually afford it, the 1889, which is very expensive. I mean, way up there. Even in not mint state, it's absolutely a fortune to purchase. Another thing people are looking for are the DMPLs or PLs. DMPL means deep marrow proof-like, or PL means proof-like. Now, if you're not going for Carson City coins or the deep marrow-like proof or the proof-like, or you want to combine that with even more expensive coins out there, go with the low mintage ones. One in particular I can think of is the 1893 San Francisco Mint. 77,000 coins were minted that year. Nice coin, but very expensive. 1893 Philadelphia Mint, 1893 Carson City Mint, 1893 New Orleans Mint. Any of those years are good years to have. You can also go with 1901, 1904, both of those in Philly. Those are also good coins to collect. So your best bet is to look at your mintage and consider a low mintage coin rather than a high mintage. And if you do see one with a really high mintage, you might want to look at the prices on that, because sometimes what happened, a lot of those coins were melted down. So something that might have like 7 million minted might only have about 700,000 of those left. So be a conscious consumer when you're looking for these, and check out your mintage specs and how many were melted too. Now, within the Morgan dollars, there are a ton of different varieties out there. VAMs, lots of them. Speaking of which, I can think of one right now, the Hot Lips. And this is where, when they're actually, you know, popping that coin down, they get these little weird things that happen within it, and they all do not look the same. Now, you can collect those if you're a collector, but if you're an investor, you might want to kind of move past them, because sometimes they can be difficult to sell. And you might want to stick with the Carson City or the Deep Merle Proof Likes or etc. like that, and the Key Dates, because those will be a lot easier to sell than some of the VAMs that are out there. Things I would actually avoid with the Morgans. I would avoid common dates. Common date Morgan type coins, that there are tons and millions of them out there, unless you're collecting them for bullion. If you're collecting for bullion, then yeah, go for it. But if you're collecting them and you're wanting a high yield investment, stay away from the common dates. Look out for the fakes. The 1889 CC Morgan, there are a lot of fakes out there, a lot of counterfeits, a lot of people trying to take your money. So if you purchase these, either purchase them from an authorized dealer, go out and buy yourself a Red Book. They come out every year. They've got every American coin in it. They have how many were minted, the values, even though the values do change on a weekly basis, so it's not very accurate on that. But that will help you quite a bit with the Morgan dollars. Well, guys, I hope you've enjoyed this edition of Spare Change. We've talked about the Morgan dollars. We've talked a lot about the Morgan dollars. And in the next episode, we're actually going to talk about one of my favorite coins, the Liberty Head Double Eagle. Well, you guys have a great afternoon, evening, or morning, whatever it might be where you are. If you have any questions, just shoot me over an email, suggestions for the show, anything like that. I'd love to hear it. But you guys have a great day. I'm Mark Absalon, and I'm out of here.